Good morning. Welcome to worship on this 14th Sunday after Pentecost, or what we also in the church call ordinary time. I want to welcome those who are here worshiping in the building with us and those who are joining us online for worship today. It is just so good to be worshiping together as the body of Christ. As we begin our worship this morning, I'll invite you to join me in a moment of silence as we prepare ourselves to worship. Our opening hymn is Gather Us In. I will invite you to rise in body and spirit as you are able as we praise God through music. And just a reminder at this time that we ask you not to sing for safety reasons, but if you desire, you are welcome to hum along or move to the, as the music moves you to do so. Please rise. Protect us from all dangers that attack us from the outside, and cleanse us from all evil that arises from within ourselves, that we may be preserved through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 15, and I will invite you to read these verses with responsively. Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle? Who may abide upon your holy hill?
Those who keep your commandments in sight and do what is right, and speak the truth from their heart.
They do not slander with the tongue. They do no evil to their friends. They do not cast discredit upon a neighbor. They do not give their money in hope of gain, nor do they take bribes against the innocent. Those who do these things shall never be overthrown. I'll invite you to rise again as you are able for our gospel acclamation.
Amen. Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders, and they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition.'" Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Washing our hands. I think unless you're in healthcare or food services, it's perhaps safe to say that you have not thought about hand washing as much in the last year and a half as any other time in your life. At least that's true for me. I mean, apart from we know to wash our hands, but I think of the public service announcements that went out about how to do it safely and how long to do it. That was a new one for me, that you had to wash for 20 seconds to get the viruses off your hands. We all know the drill. Now, of course, if we did it before, we know how important washing our hands is for sanitation, for preventing the transmission of disease. And that's why when I hear this story, especially now, after everything we've lived through the last year and a half, I kind of want to say, wait a second, Jesus. Don't you know that there's a very good reason for washing hands, that it's the sanitary thing to do? The Pharisees were having this conflict with Jesus about washing hands. And it is important to say, to note, that for the Pharisees, hand washing wasn't about health the way it is for us today. For Pharisees, hand washing was a symbolic act. It was an expression of washing away those spiritual impurities so that you could be ritually and spiritually clean before God. It was sort of a physical act that you could do that would mirror that inner state. And so getting rid of germs and dirt, well, that was just an added bonus. When Jesus challenges the Pharisees on this question of hand washing, Jesus doesn't disagree that there are certain things that defile a person, things that can make someone unclean. It's just that the things that make a person truly unclean aren't what his opponents think they are. So for Jesus, the issue of hand washing, it's not really the issue. Hand washing is neither a good thing or a bad thing in terms of the point that Jesus is wanting to make. What he is trying to say is it doesn't solve the problem, that what truly defiles a person are the thoughts and the behaviors that come out, not the food that goes in. Jesus' point is this: you can wash your hands 100 times, but if you still hold bad thoughts and intentions in your heart, clean hands aren't going to matter. Hand washing isn't going to help you if you're guilty of sexual sins, of theft, murder, adultery, greed, evil intentions, deceit, unrestrained immorality, envy, insults, arrogance, or foolishness. It's a long list. inside that counts. What I find most challenging is exactly that. The fact that these things that Jesus lists, most of them aren't things that are easily visible to others. So, for example, you know, it's pretty easy to see if someone hasn't washed their hands. You know, as you're getting ready for a meal or to do something, you can see if somebody doesn't do that. It's very visible. It's not always easy, though, to see when someone is being deceitful or envious or foolish or prideful. I mean, sometimes it is, but it's not always. A lot of the things on Jesus' list are things that might ever only be known to the person, to ourselves. And that's also if we're willing, if we're able to admit or acknowledge that we are indeed guilty of any of these behaviors or thought patterns. This is both the challenge and the blessing of Jesus' teaching. Yeah, it's hard that when impurity is something that begins within us, it's not as easy to see, it's not as easy to discern when someone else has sinned, when we have sinned. The blessing, though, is that it takes away some of that power for others to judge us and for us to judge others. Jesus' redefinition takes away the power to judge. It invites us to see the actions of other people in the best light, to give other people the benefit of the doubt, to be gracious and merciful. I know I've shared this example before, but it's a good one, and from one of my favorite authors, Brené Brown. She tells about a time that she was conducting research on this question. Do you think that in general, people are doing the best that they can? It's a big question, and I think many of us would answer that in very different ways. And so she'd been doing this research, she'd already posed this question to a lot of people when she was at home sitting around with her husband, and she thought she'd ask him too. He's a medical doctor, he works with lots of families and people, and so she wanted to know what his thought was on this question. And his answer was this: I don't know. I really don't. All I know is that my life is better when I assume that people are doing their best. It keeps me out of judgment and lets me focus on what is and not what should or could be. Brené Brown shares the story and she reflects on this. Because when she heard that, all she could say was his answer felt like truth. Not an easy truth, but truth. And I hope it is for you. I know when I hear that, it rings true for me. We know that every behavior, whether it's positive or negative, it does have power to multiply. Negative behavior, I think we're perhaps more aware of that. We can think of lots of examples. When we see negative things happen or feel somebody is being negative and that impacts on us, we see how that energy, those actions can multiply and spread, not unlike a virus. But love has power too. Love and forgiveness and non-judgment have the power to multiply and grow just as much. And I'm sure we can think of examples of that in our lives too. Certainly we can look to Jesus and his ministry, the following that grew around him as he traveled, sharing these kinds of messages. In Jesus, we see that when grace and mercy meet selfishness and hate, that in the end, grace and mercy win out. And that's because ultimately grace and mercy don't come from us. These gifts come from God. As followers of Jesus, as ones who seek to follow in his way, to follow by the law of love, we do our best. We do our best to avoid that list of things that Jesus gives us, those behaviors, those vices. We do our best each day to follow God's command to love, to forgive, to be generous, and to do that even when others around us are behaving badly, when they're not doing those things. That's what it means to be a Christian, to follow Christ. We strive to be more, to live up to the potential that God has placed within each one of us, to continually grow in righteousness, to be more, and to, so that more and more our actions will match up with what God intends for us, what it means to be a beloved child of God. We do this because our hope is that the power of love can and will overcome the power of sin in the world. This is what we strive for, but we fall short many times. We will not ever be perfect in these things because we are human. That's why we need the power of Jesus. Jesus' love within us to purify our hearts again and again so that we can try again. In his letter to the Romans, the Apostle Paul reminds us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're always in need of that gift of forgiveness so that we aren't bound or held captive by those thoughts and words and deeds that create divisions among us and with God, those things that bring hurt instead of healing. So this morning, I invite us, I encourage us to hold fast to that promise, that gift of forgiveness that flows freely from God. May God's grace and mercy flow in us and through us. May it purify our hearts so that what comes out of us, our actions, our words, that those things will be a blessing to others. Amen. As we think about forgiveness this morning, I thought this is an appropriate time in our worship service to have a time of confession and forgiveness. So I will invite you, I know it's very hot in here for those who are in the building. If you're okay, you're welcome to stand or stay seated, how you feel comfortable as we join in this time of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life. Us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. As you are able, I'll invite you to rise in body and spirit for our hymn of the day, Lord, let my heart be good soil.
Amen.
Angels said it to startled shepherds. Jesus said it to frightened followers. And now these words which come from heaven are shared to make us whole and make us one. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Those of us who are worshiping at home, I invite you to greet. If you're with someone, greet them with a sign of peace, or take this moment to send a text or message to someone that you haven't checked in with for a while. Those of us who are here in the building, I invite you to stay in your places and turn and wave or give a sign of peace to those around you. I now invite us to come before God in thanksgiving, and as the words of our offertory hymn invite us to offer our hands and our whole selves to God in this time. Children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. We pray for the church, that it is a safe haven for all who seek your presence. Fill it with pastors, deacons, and leaders who echo your expansive and generous welcome. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the whole of creation, that plants and animals have the habitat and resources to thrive and flourish. Inspire us to protect threatened habitats and ensure a sustainable future for generations to come. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for individuals in positions of authority, especially in this time leading up to the 44th general election. Raise up wise and discerning leaders in federal, provincial, and local governments, and guide them to seek the benefit of every person. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are in need. Support and encourage those who are unemployed, underemployed, or experiencing poverty. Bring food, shelter, clothes, and stability for daily life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this congregation, and especially for those beginning a new school year. Empower teachers and school administrators. Guide students in their learning and development. Accompany the grown-ups who provide encouragement and love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our siblings in Christ, for the people of Main Street United Church in Mitchell and their pastor, Tom Dunbar, for the people of St. Ansgar Lutheran Church in London and their pastor, David Wirt. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those in our weekly St. Peter's prayer cycle, Rose and Susan, Greg and Barb, John and Lori, and Brad, Lisa, and Tori. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, as we gather them into one by praying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy You may be seated for a couple of announcements. Next week is the long weekend. September 5th is the Sunday. There will be no service here at St. Peter's next week. Instead, we invite you to join in worship at the Mitchell Fall Fair, which will be an outdoor worship at the Mitchell Fairgrounds. The service is at 9:30 a.m. For those who are wanting an online option, what we will have is the sermon that's being provided by our national church for the summer sermon series will be emailed out and shared next Sunday morning. So if you show up here, you'll be out of luck. The doors will be locked, but we will be here back again on September 12th. And we hope and we pray that as we move into the fall, with kids returning to school, that we will be able to continue worshiping here in the building. That is our plan, worship each Sunday at 10 a.m. And beginning late in September, we are too hoping to introduce Holy Communion back to our worship as well. We've been making plans for how to do that safely. And as long as, again, the world continues to be okay, and we know that that can change as we've experienced again and again over these months, that is our tentative plan moving forward. I will invite you to stand now. Jean, go ahead. Thanks, Jean. So Jean was just letting us know for the fall fair service, it is a drive-in service, but you are allowed to bring lawn chairs if you'd like to sit outside your vehicle as long as you maintain your 6 feet between households.
So it's not a house.
Yes.
The donations of the church service are going to two different locations, but it's the money that's going to one location. I can't remember what the name of that or my visions at this point. But you can also bring stuff to the food bank.
So non-perishable food, okay.
Non-perishable goods,
go
someplace else.
So, and if there's donations, we're not sure what the organization for monetary donations, but they will be receiving donations of food for the food bank. Oh, yes, the information will be in the advocate, yeah. Please stand to receive God's blessing. The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn is For the Beauty of the Earth.